You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are life, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you are
Pastor Mike has been with us for just 1 week, and we fly back today. But that 1 week has been like we've been together for 9 years. Our hairstyles are the same. Our twang is the same. You know, today we just said it, you know, only this is me, use the color. But I'll give you mine.
Hallelujah.
But thank you for being a brother, a friend, a pastor, and a father. We thank God for your church that released you to us and your family. We want to ask that may you please carry on preaching so you travel back to the United States. And I'm sure this is not the last time we see each other. You'll be seeing us visiting this many of these black suits you're seeing down here. Amen. The black suits, the glory of God. Put your hands together for Pastor Michael, right? You see, one thing that we've lost, especially in the United States, is that we've lost the idea of listening to our elders. We've lost the concept of respect for the people who have been where we are trying to go. It's very important for us to take a moment, and I know that we have all this knowledge and education, but knowledge and education does not guarantee wisdom. Knowledge is fine. You can read a book and get knowledge. But the way to use your knowledge, or how you use knowledge, is wisdom. So it's very important for us to listen to those that have gone the way that we're trying to go. So here, though, there's a problem. There's a big problem with him being older, with him being over 100 years old. There was a huge issue here because he had no real successor. There was no one to take the reins from him when he would go the way of the earth. That's a problem because when we look out the scriptures, we see individuals who had successors. They had people to take over the ministry and to take over the nation once they left. I mean, come on, let's look at successors even at the beginning. Abraham had Isaac. Isaac had Jacob. Even the prophets later, Elijah had Elisha. And all of the kings, they brought forth their sons to take over the nation if they were good kings. And so here we find that Joshua had no one really necessarily to take over the reins of the nation. And this was a problem. This was an issue because the people of Israel had already shown signs of disobedience. And if they showed the signs of disobedience under Joshua, what would they do when Joshua left? You remember the scriptures, how the nation of Israel was divided up and given to the different tribes of Israel. God spoke something to the nation of Israel. You remember? He spoke something through Joshua, and he told the people, I want you, when you come into your nations and when you come into your areas, I want you to drive the people out that live there. I want you to get rid of them. Take them and get them completely out. Do not make covenants with them. Do not allow them to live with you. And do not enslave them. Because I don't want you to treat them the same way that the Egyptians treated you. I want my personality of freedom. I want my name to be glorified. Slaves there, they're not going to understand the true love of God. So I want you not to enslave them, but drive them out. And don't make a covenant with them. Don't live with them. Because when you live with them, guess what? You'll never take full possession of the land. You see, God has given us possession for the areas of our life that are necessary for the will of God to be complete in your life. God has given you possession over certain areas, but you will never have full possession sharing time with the devil. You will never have full possession of what God has in store for you when you compromise with the people that are around you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So here, there's this issue. There's no successor. What will the people do? Because the people, they compromise. They did not drive out the Amorites that were in the nation. And there were some nations that even enslaved the Amorites. They were disobedient to them. So there was an issue. There was an issue with the people of Israel already. So what happened? The Bible said that Joshua had to deal with this because he was getting ready to go the way of the earth. He was getting ready to die. He was older at this time. So what happened? He gathered all the nations together at Shechem. Shechem was a very symbolic place. A very symbolic place. This was the place where Abraham first built his first altar to the Lord. And not only was this a symbolic place, because this was the first altar that Abraham built, but it was also the place, the valley, where Moses brought the people. And on one side was Mount Ebal. And on the other side is Mount Gerizim. And on Mount Ebal, he said, I want six of the tribes to get over here. And I want them to yell out the curses that will come to the nation if they are disobedient. And on the other side, on Mount Gerizim,
and for them to get out the blessings that will come on the nation if they obey the Lord. And then in the middle, you tell them to choose. In the middle, you have them say, amen. You see, in the middle, they had to choose between them.
They had to choose between, can you all hear me?
Amen. They had to choose between Mount Ebal, or they had to choose between Gerizim. This was their choices that they had. And Joshua brought them right back to the same place. And when he brought them back to this place, he looked at them in their face and said, look here, God has been good to you. He went down the history of the nation of Israel. He said, listen, I brought you up from your father Abraham. Back when they didn't even know anything about God, where they didn't even worship God, they didn't even know anything about the glory of Jehovah in the house. I lifted you up out of there. And not only did I say, I do that, but I blessed you when your people went down into Egypt. I delivered you. I brought you out of the hands of the most powerful army in the world at that time. I delivered you. And guess what? You didn't have swords. You didn't have spears. You didn't have guns. You didn't have bullets. But I delivered you out of Pharaoh's hand. Don't you remember that I led you by a cloud by day, and I led you by fire by night? Listen, and then when the enemy came against you, and when it really looked bad, and it looked like the enemy was going to get through the barriers that I put up, do you know what happened? The Bible said that they crossed over through the Red Sea. And when they crossed over the Red Sea, the scriptures made plain that the enemy tried to chase them. But God had already spoken a word to the nation. And you know what he told them? He said that the enemy that you see today, you will never see again. You see, I'm here to tell you right now, God wants to do that in your life. God wants to bless you so much that the enemy that's been trying to tear you down, the enemy that's been trying to destroy you, oh, that habit and that addiction, or whatever the issue, whatever the problem, whatever the issue, God is saying, I want to deliver you so much today that you'll never have to deal with that thing again. Come on, somebody say amen. I believe that. And you know what else he told them? The scriptures say that Joshua was telling the people, don't you remember what happened when I blessed you with Balaam, the king of Moab, Balak? He tried to hire Balaam to curse the people of God. But I took that curse out of his mouth, and I put a blessing in his mouth. Because guess what, saints? You can't curse what God has blessed. You listen, if God has blessed you, there is no one that can steal your blessing. If God has opened up a door in your life, there is no man that can shut that door. If God has shut a door in your life, there is no man that can open that door. If God has blessed you, just blessed. If you anointed, you just anointed. If you're blessed, look at your neighbor and say, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. Now look back at it and say, ain't nothing you can do about it. Come on, somebody, put your hands together and give God the glory. Now that Now that you're in the same place that Moses stood, and Abraham stood, and Isaac stood, and Jacob stood, now you have got to make a decision. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Make a decision in your life. Listen, he tells them you can go back and serve the gods that your father Abraham, before Abraham, his father served, before they even knew anything about God. Or you can serve the gods of the Amorites, those people that you were supposed to drive out, but you did not. Or, listen, you can serve my God. You can serve them, you can serve that mess that's around you, or you can serve the true God. Now that's your choice what you do. But they said, look here, I'm 100 years old. And as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. You see, that's where you have to get in life, where you quit worrying about everybody else. You can't control what your neighbor does. You can't control what people around you do. You have to make up in your mind for yourself that God, for you, I'm going to live, and for you, I'm going to die. And everything in between, that's what I'm going to give to you. God, I'm going to serve you with tenacity. I'm going to serve you like, see, in America, they say, we're going to serve you like a pit bull. We're going to get upset. We're going to turn our face towards Flint, like, and make our face like Flint, and say, God, I'm not going to turn to the right. I'm not going to turn to the left. I'm not going to go backwards, but I'm going to press my way, and I'm going to go forward.
God saved me from mess.
serve the gods of the Amorites. In other words, the people that are around you, your neighbors, you can act like them. In other words, you can just kind of fit in. You know, the New Testament says kind of lukewarm, where you're not hot, you're not cold, but I just kind of be like everybody else. I carry my Bible on Sunday, but on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, I'm going to fit in with the crowd. See, y'all feeling real good today. Everybody in here looks born again. Everybody in here looks saved. You fit in. But when you get out of that, that's when you start looking different. Are you afraid to look different? Are you afraid? Has God not been good enough to you that you can stand with him outside of these walls? Has God not been good enough to you? What more does God have to do? He saved you. He delivered you. He blessed you. He gave you life. He gave you the Holy Ghost on the inside. What more does God have to do? He said, I promised you a greater life. I promised you all of these things, and I have yet to break one of my promises. My track record is perfect. So, saints of God, I think you need to make a decision. And I'm calling out the people of God today. It's up to you now to choose to serve the Lord. I challenge you all this morning. I challenge you right here. I challenge you, and I would ask of you now to choose God with everything that you have. If your faith as a Christian is not affecting every aspect of your life, then that means that there are parts of your life that you have not given over to Christ. I am telling you now, every facet of your life should be affected by your faith in Jesus Christ. So if there are parts of your life that are not directly influenced by your relationship with Jesus, then guess what? That's an area that you have not given over. I am saying, please submit today to the will of God. I've come all the way from Chicago, Illinois, to tell you to surrender your full will to God. I'm not saying you're not a Christian. I'm not saying that you're not saved. I'm not saying that you haven't been baptized and born again. I'm not saying that. But I am saying that there are parts of our will that we don't give over to God, that we don't surrender. And that's what God is trying to get across to us today. Give God everything. Give him everything today. And guess what? When you give God everything, that means that you will always have everything. If you give God everything, then he will always pay you back with interest. Give him everything today. So I'm calling you out. I'm calling you. Don't leave out of this place the same way that you came in. I am telling you today. I'm asking you. I am begging you today. I want to pray with you. I want to lay hands on you today. And I want to, not that my laying on of hands will do anything, because it's your mind, it's your heart, it's you that have to make the decision. But I want to touch and agree with you today, because as you're on this altar, guess what? I'm on this altar too, because I want to give God more of my life. I want to surrender more unto God. The areas in my life that I know I need to surrender more to. And this trip coming over here all the way to Kenya has shown and revealed to me some things about my own life. So when you come down to this altar today, we are sharing the altar on today. So I want you now, please, let me pray with you. Come to the altar now. Please come. If there's one, please come now to the altar. That's right. Come on. Don't be shamed. Don't be shamed. And don't be shy. You come to this altar. And I believe that God will move in your life. I believe that things will change heavily and mightily in your life as we fully surrender our all over to Christ. Is there one more, please? That's right. That's right. Come on. Don't think about it. Just say, God, I know I need you. Don't let your friends that are around you right now cause you to be shamed. Don't let your friends that are around you, because when you stand before God, it's only going to be you and God. Not your friends. It's going to be you and God. And when the opportunity like this comes, well, the Lord has
our peace.
You are peace, you are peace. When my fear is crippling, you are truth, even in my wandering. You are joy,